presenting today's invocation, Rabbi Barry Dovekatz.
Words of Rabbi Rick Sherwin. Dear God, the world may laugh at our dreams, but no matter, we still believe. We believe in tomorrow. We believe that we have the power to make tomorrow different than today. We believe that poverty need not be permanent, that alienation need not be forever, that we can make our streets safe and that we can educate our children and see past the false notion that our differences outweigh the things that we have in common. We believe in humanity, despite all that we know about ourselves. We believe that leaders can inspire, that they can prove themselves worthy of our trust, that they can help us remember what it is like to dream, and we pray for them today. We believe that there can yet be a time of justice, a time of virtue, a time of fellowship, a time of sharing, and a time of shalom, of tranquility for our city, for our country, and for our beautiful Bronx, and for all who live on earth. We believe in tomorrow, for God has guided us in how to live today. The world may laugh at our dreams, those precious visions that God provides to remind us of what we might yet become. No matter, we still believe.
Ladies and gentlemen, our Deputy Borough President, Aurelia Green.
Good morning, and I'm delighted to be here this morning with all of you. Before I introduce the star of the hour, I want to acknowledge some dignitaries who have joined us this morning, and we thank you for being with us. We have with us the New York City Comptroller, John Liu, City Council Speaker, Christine Quinn, Bronx District Attorney, Robert Johnson, Staten Island Borough President, James Molinaro, Manhattan Borough President, Scott Stringer, New York State Senator Jeff Klein, New York State Senator Ruben Diaz Sr., New York State Senator Gustavo Rivera, Assemblyman Carl Hasty, Assemblywoman Carmen Arroyo, Assemblyman Jeff Dinowitz, Assemblywoman Vanessa Gibson, Assemblyman Nelson Castro, Assemblyman David Weprin, Councilmember Joel Rivera, the Majority Leader, Councilmember Annabel Palmer, Councilmember Helen Diane Foster, Councilmember G. Oliver Coppell, Councilmember Maria del Carmen Arroyo, Councilmember James Vaca, Councilmember Fernando Cabrera, Councilmember Melissa Mark Verito, City of Yonkers Council President Chuck Lesnick, Majority Leader Yonkers City Council, Patricia McDowell, former Assemblyman Adam Clayton Powell, Bronx County Clerk Louis Diaz, former City Council Speaker Gifford Miller, former Assemblyman Stephen Kaufman, and former council member June Eisland. And we've also been joined by New York City public advocate Bill de Blasio. Thank you all. Thank you for being with us today. You know, it's been almost 2 years since the borough president and I came to Borough Hall. And I must say it's been one of the highlights of my life. And I thank him for that. Our borough president, Ruben Diaz Jr., is a true visionary. He doesn't look at our borough in which he was born and lives as it currently exists, but as what he sees it becoming, God's country. He's not just a visionary who dwells on his dreams, but he's a man of action who takes on thankless tasks to better the conditions of the people in the Bronx. So we can describe him as a visionary who gets things done. Don't you agree? Who champions causes, who strives to put his actions where his mouth is, and who describes the Bronx's people as one Bronx. Recently, a biography video of a contestant shown on American Idol gave a national audience an extremely narrow look at the Bronx, reinforcing stereotypical views of our borough that we have fought hard against for a long time and that are very difficult to erase. While we certainly do not view ourselves through rose-colored glasses, it is simply wrong to paint the Bronx with such a broad negative brush. In response, the borough president issued a clarion call to all Bronxites to defend our borough, and of course, Bronxites answered that call. To answer the idle video, some Bronx artists, with the help of BronxNet, have put together this video with the hopes it will eventually go viral on the internet and help erase once and for all the clouded, stereotypical, and one-sided views of the truly beautiful Bronx. They call it X Marks the Spot.
When they showed excerpts of the Bronx in a minute and a half, what they essentially did was they disrespected us in the Bronx. They erased 2.5 decades of hard work by elected officials, by community leaders, community organizations. We're so tired of being depicted in a negative light. There's so much wonderful things happening here, from our cultural institutions to our parks, our beach, our restaurants, and that's what we want people in the world to see.
Journey, tell you where I'm from. Yeah, the boogie down Bronx like Harris won. Let's start a revolution and shine like the sun. This is a movement, I march to the drum. Who doesn't know the Yankees, the great franchise, and the pioneers of hip hop, the Furious Five. We built to survive, see the fire in my eyes. Take a walk in the X, feel the streets come alive. Fordham the point, see I'm proving my point. Grand Concourse, sound view, let's rejoice. Feel the vibe in my voice. I do this for the people, the home of the best. Headlines for the
B to the O, to the O, to the X, to the B, to the O, to the O, and X, to the B, to the O, to the O, and X, to the B, to the O, to the O,
and X. The world revolves around the Bronx, they just don't know it. So we made it a hot song for the people to take notice. Some of the most influential people came from this borough, like Colin Powell, Ralph Lauren, and Al Pacino. Who doesn't enjoy a good book from Edgar Allan Poe? Or how about some good music from Luther Vandross? You could be who you want to be if you from out here. Supreme Court judge, like Sonia Sotomayor. There may be struggles, but there's love in my borough. And if you from here, anywhere else, you're thorough. We some hardworking people in a city that never sleeps. And we started the music where the world moves at
feet. To the O, to the O, to the N, X,
whenever somebody speaks negatively of the borough, defend your borough. Defend where we come from. Defend how beautiful it is. Defend all of the assets that we have here.
I've always been annoyed by the people who say, oh, the Bronx. It just annoys me. It still annoys me. And I say there are three places in the world with the in front of them. The Vatican, the Hague, and the Bronx.
The Bronx and I have been through some bad times and some good times, and boy, the good times are definitely here.
I'm proud of where you came from, because I always was. Everybody, I think a lot of people are like, oh, well, I'm from, you know, and they always make something up. I was always proud of where I was from. And always came back home.
It's always wonderful to come back to the Bronx. You know, before I was Maria from Sesame Street, I like to tell people I was Sonia from the Bronx, and I just love to come back and see it growing and changing the way it has been.
Because you got a lot of guys coming up now, you know, thinking that they rapping or thinking that they really doing something. And if you lived in the Bronx, if you're supposed to be talking about the streets that you grew up in, and if you didn't write nothing about that Bronx Zoo, and if you didn't write nothing about that beloved Yankee Stadium, then you definitely wasn't rapping about or representing the Bronx where I come from. So long live the Bronx.
I do have a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, but the Bronx Walk of Fame means a heck of a lot more than that for me.
Ladies and gentlemen, the president of the borough of the Bronx, Ruben Diaz Jr. All right, it's the Bronx in the house. Let's give it up to the artists as well as BronxNet for that wonderful video, right? I want to thank Senator Diaz for writing the lyrics to that rap song. Nah, I know he did it. I just want to say to my deputy borough president, thank you for all that you stand for. Thank you for the support that you've given us at Borough Hall. Thank you for being that source of energy that the Bronx needs. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for the deputy borough president, O'Reilly. Could you please stand up? Stand up, O'Reilly, stand up. I also want to make mention, I know that all of the dignitaries have been mentioned here today. I want to thank all of you for coming out to this historic high school, DeWitt Clinton. But I would be remiss if I don't point out the person who's given me life. And you all know that I make sure, I make it a point that whenever mommy's around, that papi doesn't get all the credit. Mami, te quiero mucho. Gracias por todo que tú has hecho en mi vida. Ladies and gentlemen, my mother, Hilda Diaz.
That's one Hilda in my life. You all know I have another Hilda in my life. And mommy gives me all the love. Hilda gives me all the cocotazos. She's here with my baby. My oldest couldn't be here. We are so proud and thankful that little Ruben, he doesn't want to be called that anymore, is in his freshman year at Boston College. Yeah. No matter what I go, what experiences I have, the most wonderful thing that I've been given is been given to me besides my life has been my two children. And so, honey, Hilda, thank you for giving me Ryan. Look at my baby. This is my baby. Ryan, stand up. We're also joined here by my sister, who's a sergeant at the police department, Sergeant Diaz. Thank you, Damaris. My nephew, who just got accepted to Fordham Prep. We're proud of him, Billy Kylie. I have another family member, but I'm going to mention her a little later on. Ladies and gentlemen, I thought it was also great to highlight, as we saw not only in the video, but to highlight the talent that we have in this borough. And when you see the Grave Shift, aren't they amazing? Aren't they amazing? Now, they're amazing for so many different reasons. They're not only a wonderful musical group, but they are family. And they're from right here in God's country, the borough of the Bronx, and they represent us well. So give it up for Grave Shift once again. So 1 year ago, we came together just a few miles from here to celebrate our home, the Bronx, and our shared accomplishments. Today, we come together to discuss not only how far we have come, but where we are headed. We come together to celebrate our efforts to make every neighborhood, every single block, even better. We come together to stand up against those who denigrate our home. And as we did last year, we come together as one Bronx, un solo Bronx. One Bronx is embodied in all of you who sit here today, who have been working tirelessly for years, if not decades, to make the Bronx a better place. Together, we are expanding that vision and executing a plan that centers on holistic, intelligent development, a development plan which prioritizes greening our borough at every opportunity. A plan that creates good, livable jobs. A plan that helps assist those businesses seeking to operate here. A plan that builds more parks and affordable housing. A development plan that serves all of our borough's needs. Our goal, our commitment, is to raise the standards and expectations for all in this borough. We will fix the way we do business in this city by forcing corporations that lobby for taxpayer handouts to do better by the men and women they employ. We will not simply accept business as usual. We will change the pay structure of the city, ensuring that a living wage goes hand in hand with heavily subsidized development. Developers must do more for the Bronx. City Hall and city agencies must do more for the Bronx. And we, the residents of the Bronx, must also do more as well. We know from speaking with, working with, and living with each other the great strides that we have made over the past 30 years. It is time to share that story with the world. And ladies and gentlemen, there's no better place or no better time to start than right here, today, right here and right now. This chapter of the story begins with our children. As Mayor Dinkins once said, our children are our future. So I'm so proud to report that we have, for the second year in a row, provided the highest amount of funding to schools in the history of my office. The more than $12 million and funding we have provided to Bronx schools will go towards new playground equipment, smart boards, physical plant upgrades, and other major improvements to schools in every corner of the borough. And we're not done. Our office continues to meet regularly with principals and administrators from the Bronx schools at all levels through our education consortia to discuss their challenges and develop workable solutions. And we will do more. Recently, I appointed Monica Major, a longtime parent advocate and Morris Park resident, to serve as my representative to the panel for educational policy. I am thrilled to have her as part of my team. Monica, I saw you around there somewhere. Could you please stand up and take a bow? This is Monica Major. Thank you for your service. Together, Monica and I will both recognize and build on the many great achievements happening in our schools. For instance, in Mount Haven, MS 223 was honored this year by Intel as one of the top math schools in the nation. For their efforts, MS 223 will not only receive cash, grants, and prizes totaling $160,000, but they will also continue to set the bar by which all other public middle schools will be measured. Over the holiday break, the choir at Celia Cruz High School of Music showed off just how special their talents are. You can clap it up for them as well. They did this by winning the title of Best Choir in all of New York City at the Bronx Zoo's first ever Sing for Wildlife competition. They defeated schools from every corner of the city. Now, we already knew the Bronx was number one, and we thank the choir for going out and proving it. Now we can all sing it from the rooftops. Discovery High School in Kingsbridge Heights continues to lead the city and the nation in green initiatives. 9 of its students completed a nationally recognized employment training program in green wall and green roof installation. In November, I proudly joined them when they were highlighted by NBC as a national leader. Get a load of that. A national leader in green innovation and given a chance to construct a green wall at Rockefeller Center. Our schools are doing great things, yet there's a great deal of work that still needs to be done. Last year, I correctly noted that while the Department of Education touted record high scores on the state assessment test, the results of the national test made it clear that something was wrong with our state system. An investigation by the state further confirmed that for years, the scores on those tests have been grossly inflated. That is why this fall, my office will host an education summit, which will bring together the best minds on education from not only the Bronx, but from across the nation. Through this summit, we will develop strong new ideas on curriculum, on overcrowding, and on expanding our charter schools. We will work... We have some charter school fans here. We will work to foster innovation while also making our public schools, once again, the best in the nation. We will put forward new ideas to make sure all students, from our most gifted to those who need extra help and everyone in between, are being served by our public school system. Our children must be prepared to enter college and the workforce. And the only way we're going to make sure that happens is to guarantee that our public schools are the best they can possibly be. Our schools are getting healthier and safer as well. For several years, my office, along with concerned parents and the New York Lawyers for the Public Interest, has led a campaign to compel the Department of Education to acknowledge the crisis of PCBs in our public schools and to fix the problem. Recently, the extent of the contamination has been proven to be citywide. Now, we all know that PCBs are extremely toxic chemicals that for so many years were unwittingly put in building materials used in schools. PCBs are particularly dangerous to the health of both our children and school workers. I don't know about you, but I think we can all agree that schools are no place for our children to be exposed to dangerous pollutants. There is nothing more important than our children being safe while they're getting the proper education that they need. Thanks to the efforts of our coalition, which also includes Congress members Jose Serrano, Joseph Crowley, and Jerry Nadler from Manhattan. Let's clap it up for those guys. The EPA has demanded, the federal agency has demanded that the city test and remediate PCBs from all schools that may be at risk. I'm happy to report that this administration has finally made an attempt to treat the PCB issue seriously. They have proposed, as of yesterday, a plan that would allocate $700 million to remove these contaminants from nearly 800 public school buildings over the 10-year period. Now, this is a step in the right direction, but the timetable is grossly inadequate, if you ask me. In announcing this program, the city has conceded that our schools have a real problem. We need a faster response, however. The health of our children is at risk. We will never stop our efforts to protect our children from this serious threat. And let me be clear, PCBs are not just a Bronx issue, but this is a citywide issue as well. And we will work to make sure every elected official in the city of New York makes this a priority. Remediating PCB contamination is just one way that we have made health a priority for our school administrators. Last year, in partnership with the New York City Strategic Alliance for Health, we helped create the Excellence in School Wellness Awards. These awards recognize elementary schools for their efforts in creating a healthy school environment. This is key to preventing childhood obesity and improving academic achievements. We encourage all Bronx elementary schools to apply, and in due course, we will expand the awards to middle and high schools as well. My hope is that our schools can one day be measured not only by using test scores, but also by the health and physical fitness of their students. To this end, we have hosted the first ever Bronx Food Summit. Kristen Quinn was with us there, which brought together individuals and organizations from across the city, such as healthcare institutions, food justice advocates, or people like me who just love to eat, to spend the day discussing strategies to bring more nutritious food choices to our borough and to make sure Bronxites can and will take advantage of them. The event was wildly successful and has led to the creation of a working group that has spent months developing and supporting health programs for the Bronx residents who need them the most. We have great stories across the Bronx, not just in schools, but in all walks of life. This year, we were able to provide $37.6 million in funding to worthy organizations in every corner of the Bronx. That's a lot of money. We are helping to renovate libraries in Woodlawn, Castle Hill, and Westchester Square. We are contributing to the redevelopment of the Lehman Center for the Performing Arts, just a few blocks from where we sit today. And yes, we must provide our children with a quality education, but we must also improve where they live and where they play. Parks all over our borough are getting much needed improvements thanks to the partnership of the local elected officials many of you see here today. For instance, working with Assemblyman Marco Crespo and City Councilwoman Maria del Carmen Arroyo, new playground equipment and revitalized green space are headed to Fox Playground in Longwood. Council member Joel Rivera and Jimmy Vaca have teamed up with me to rebuild Van Ness Park. State Senator Jeff Klein and Assembly Member Michael Benedetto and I are partnering to improve Belden Point, a beautiful waterfront park on City Island. Also, City Councilwoman Helen Foster and Assemblywoman Vanessa Gibson and I are partnering to improve Rockin' Roots Park in Highbridge. In fact, 12% of our total budget allocation, nearly $5 million, has gone to park reconstruction across the Bronx. Together, teaming up with local officials and community organizations, we are making sure that our Bronx kids have the green space that they deserve. Preserving our existing parks and greenways is a major priority. That is why this summer, thousands of Bronxites stood together to protest the removal of old growth trees along Pelham Parkway as part of the roadway's long-awaited reconstruction. While this project is critical to improving the safety of motorists and pedestrians alike, it must move forward with minimal impact to the beautiful trees that line the scenic byway. Hence, I was pleased to assist in the establishment of a task force specifically created to oversee the preservation of these historic trees. I look forward to working with the Pelham Parkway Save the Trees campaign, Community Board 11, the Pelham Parkway Preservation Alliance, local elected officials, and the city to ensure that all viable trees along the parkway are protected during the course of this project. To quote the great philosopher, Dr. Seuss, from his book, The Lorax. It's a wonderful book. Maybe we should start a book club here in the Bronx. To quote Dr. Seuss, he says, "I speak for the trees have no tongues. The trees along Pelham Parkway in our green space, in neighborhoods across the Bronx, they cannot protect or speak for themselves. Like Dr. Seuss so eloquently said, it is our job to protect and to speak out for them." Like parks, we have made great strides in improving housing. Our office has thrown its support behind major rezoning efforts that will lead to the increased development in areas that are primed for new growth, including those in Bedford Park, Norwood, and East Tremont and Third Avenues. Of course, my office, over the course of the first 2 years as borough president, I have successfully leveraged, now get a load of this, $16 million in capital allocations into $442 million of housing development here in our borough. My support has facilitated the construction and or the preservation of over 1,800 units of housing across 20 different projects of all types, including moderate income home ownership, affordable mixed income rentals, and supportive housing for our veterans, victims of domestic abuse, and others with special needs. In fact, senior citizen housing represents the greatest number of projects receiving my support. And we didn't just fund new housing projects either. We also took steps to enhance and improve our existing housing inventory. Since I first became borough president, I have been working to assist the tenants living in neglected Bronx buildings. Many of these buildings were crumbling around them, while real estate speculators, interested only in profit, took advantage, if not outright abused, hardworking Bronxites. In many cases, the treatment of these tenants, I believe, rose to the level of criminality. I am well aware of just how bad the conditions were with the infamous Milbank and Ocelot real estate holdings, because you see, a member of my own staff was among those tenants who were being mistreated. Tenants within these buildings were denied basic human necessities, such as heat, hot water, even locks on their front doors for weeks, if not months at a time. This, ladies and gentlemen, to me is totally unacceptable. Now, we will be able to fight back early against real estate speculators who have abused the trust of both Bronx tenants and renters across the city. Last month, I joined with City Council Speaker Christine Quinn, Mayor Bloomberg, and others to launch the Proactive Preservation Initiative. Now, this is a new program that will work to identify troubled buildings and make necessary repairs before things get out of control and tenants are left in a hopeless situation. We will take advantage of these tools to ensure that what we saw with Milbank and Ocelot, as well as other distressed properties, never, ever happens again here. Just like our schools, we are working to make our housing healthier and safer as well. Consequently, we have put together a pilot program. Get a load of this. Investing $500,000 to assist low-income buildings in our borough to convert from number 4 and number 6 heating oil to either clean-burning natural gas or number 2 heating oil. Our first building is located at 530 159th Street. It is a 44-unit low-income housing, low-income cooperative, currently in the process of this conversion. This project and future projects like it will not only reduce air pollution and energy usage through the consumption of cleaner fuel, but they will also help to keep housing affordable for low-income tenants while providing a market for green jobs right here in the borough of the Bronx. Burning cleaner fuel is one important way we can improve the health of Bronx residents, but we need to do more. As part of any major project in the city, developers must submit an environmental impact statement, which analyzes the effects of physical construction on the surrounding area. But here in the Bronx, where we have some of the worst health indicators in the nation, that is not enough. We are currently researching the incorporation of a health impact statement for every major development project. Such a report would explore the health effects of land use decisions, guaranteeing that significant analysis will occur prior to planning, zoning, and development. My staff and I are currently working with City Councilwoman Maria del Carmen Arroyo, who chairs the Health Committee in the City Council, and other City Council members to develop the best way to move forward on this important proposal to ensure that new development does not have an adverse effect, an adverse impact on the health and the well-being of our neighborhoods. But we're not waiting for the rest of the city. Here in the Bronx, it is with the health of our borough in mind that we are already working toward the continual greening of our borough. We already require new projects to meet LEED certification in order to receive funding. And I call on the rest of the city's elected officials to make this a citywide mandate. As we have already shown, we're not just talking about change for new construction, but actually undertaking efforts to retrofit existing buildings to make them more environmentally friendly as well. And it gets better. You can clap for that. Protecting the environment. It gets better. We also administer the Bronx Initiative for Energy and the Environment, which works to help both new and existing businesses green their physical plant while the Bronx physical plant and make the Bronx a better place. Last year, we approved 5 loans, totaling nearly $500,000. Also, through the Bronx Empowerment Zone, we approved 20 additional loans for more than $2.3 million. For our smaller businesses, we have the Springboard Program, which offers both low and no interest microloans. More than $50,000 has been approved through the microloan program, with much more to come this year. My administration has and will continue to make intelligent economic development a reality. We have taken major steps to market the Bronx to new businesses, to support our existing businesses, and to grow the overall economy of our borough. A recent article in City Hall News commended my office for its focus on economic development, noting that the $300,000 that I allocated to support the Bronx Over Economic Development Corporation has gone a long way towards the continued revitalization of the Bronx economy. The proof is right in front of us. Since October 2009, our Business Initiative Corporation has provided 41 loans to Bronx businesses totaling just over $24 million. The BIC also has 7 loans pending, which will push another $5 million into our borough's economy. Since the end of September 2009, we have lent more than $32 million to Bronx businesses, from major corporations just entering the Bronx to mom and pop shops that have been here for years. In the past year, the BIC has increased its lending by 52%, an impressive number at any time, but even more impressive during a down economy. Late last year, our BIC was honored by the Small Business Administration as a bronze lender for their work in expanding borough business. At this rate, I believe we'll be headed to gold in no time. But ladies and gentlemen, these are more than just numbers on a page. These are the success stories of a new Bronx economy. For instance, right here in Mount Haven, we have helped Verdero, an athletic apparel and equipment company with exclusive marketing rights to Major League Baseball. With the $191,000 loan, Verdero will be able to increase their merchandise for the upcoming season, create new jobs, and expand their business beyond the borders of the Bronx. Are the good folks from the Verdero here? Could you stand up, please? Let's give them a round of applause. George Medina. In Hunts Point, specialty food supplier Gourmet Guru was able to outfit his brand new state-of-the-art warehouse with top-of-the-line environmentally friendly equipment, thanks to $300,000 in loans. Are the folks from Gourmet Guru here? Could you stand up, please? We are changing the borough's power grid as well. Two companies, C. Kenneth Imports and Flat Rate Movers, took loans to install solar panels on their roofs. Both companies will not only save money by upgrading their energy supply, but they will also reduce their carbon footprint. In June, Down East Seafood in Hunts Point was able to purchase, this is cool, an all-electric, fully refrigerated delivery truck, the only such truck on the road today in New York City. Are they here? Are they here? Take a bow. So we're leading the way with the only electric. This truck can travel 150 miles before being recharged and produces, get a load of this, 0 emissions. That's another step for a healthier Bronx. In September, we were awarded almost $270,000 by the Attorney General's office to develop a green roof in partnership with ABC Carpet and Home that will not only decrease the company's utility bills, but will also absorb rainwater and reduce stormwater runoff pollution in the Bronx River. Are the folks from ABC here? Mr. Paul Chapman, I thought he was here. There we go, Mr. Paul Chapman. Let's give him a round of applause. We're doing great things in business and the economy. And together with State Senator Jeff Klein, we were able to bring Cross County Federal Savings Bank to Van Ness. Senator, not only will this branch offer for area residents and new banking opportunity. It will also increase foot traffic on this important commercial strip. We also helped to secure $5 million in funding through the IDA for Jetro Cash and Carry, one of the most critical businesses in this region. Now, if you buy groceries or eat in a restaurant in this city, chances are that you've purchased something that originated at Jetro. Are they here today? Well, let's give them a round of applause anyway. This loan will give Jetro the ability to undergo a major green expansion at their Hunts Point facility. Providing funding is not the only way we have helped Bronx businesses in this past year. For the first time ever, thanks to our advocacy, SCORE has come to the Bronx. Through the Federal Small Business Administration, SCORE provides free counseling to startups, entrepreneurs, and businesses looking to expand. Also this year, in partnership with BOEDC, Major League Baseball and the New York Yankees held a seminar to increase their contractors and suppliers that come from right here in the Bronx. Each and every day, the BOEDC acts as a clearinghouse for Bronx businesses. We do not just provide funding, but we help with tickets, violations, infrastructure, and a variety of other issues that all businesses, both large and small, are faced with. In fact, in the last year alone, the BOEDC provided assistance, financial or otherwise, to nearly 700 Bronx businesses, and I think that's a good thing. And has made a real difference in our borough. Much of this success can be attributed to the hard work of Marlene Singh Throne, president of BOEDC and her staff. Where's Marlene? Since Marlene was brought on a year ago, she has been working tirelessly to not only bring new business to the borough, but to offer opportunities for our existing businesses to grow as well. Thank you, Marlene, and your staff. Thank you for all the work that you do. We've also been doing more to bring folks into the Bronx and to visit the Bronx through our Bronx Tourism Council. This year, the Tourism Council offered the first ever eco-tours of the Bronx. These tours give visitors the chance to take in the sights at Riverdale's Wave Hill, visit the wildlife at the Bronx Zoo, and canoe down the beautiful Bronx River. Our parks are beautiful, our waterways are gorgeous, and why shouldn't we show them off? The long-awaited visitor center at Poe Park is almost complete. This project, funded jointly by my office and City Council member Joel Rivera and scheduled to open in October, will create new public space where visitors to the Bronx will be able to get information not only on historic Poe Cottage, but the many wonderful attractions our borough has to offer. Where's Joel? Thank you, Mr. Majority Leader. When it comes to tourism, we here in the Bronx, we've had a pretty good year. More than 2 million people visited the Bronx Zoo, with almost 700,000 visiting the Botanical Garden, and there was just an article where over 1.4 million people visited the Bronx Riviera, which we know as Orchard Beach. People from all over the world, including yours truly, participated in this year's Tour the Bronx. I did the 25-mile run. Next time, I'll buy me some padded shorts. Thousands of people from all over the world. Diners continue to flock to Arthur Avenue and City Island. Visitors to the Woodlawn Cemetery can now take advantage of a new interactive audio tour that we help to fund. So you take that little device there, you go around, and it shows you all of the different sites where pioneers and people have been buried at Woodlawn Cemetery. Tourism, ladies and gentlemen, means more money to spend in our restaurants, more visitors to our major cultural institutions, and that means more commerce in our borough. Yet, despite our efforts, the growth of our tourism industry faces a major problem. We still lack a world-class hotel here in the Bronx. This is a problem we are trying tirelessly to fix. Just a few weeks ago, the Pinstripe Bowl at Yankee Stadium brought to the Bronx thousands of out-of-town visitors from as far away as Kansas. Unfortunately, fans of Syracuse and Kansas State football were unable to explore all the Bronx has to offer. While a new hotel is not here just yet, we have seen movement on a number of fronts. We have been working diligently in conjunction with the New York City Economic Development Corporation. I saw Seth Pinsky around here, Seth. Seth, thank you for coming. To bring a top-flight hotel to the area near Yankee Stadium. We have begun discussions with multiple developers who have shown a keen interest in building a 200 to a 300 bedroom hotel, complete with street level retail, restaurants, entertainment, catering, convention center, just a few blocks. I mean, you name it, we're gonna do it right there, just a few blocks away from the stadium. This development will serve as a new tourism hub for our borough, while creating hundreds of good jobs for Bronx residents and greatly enhancing the area surrounding Yankee Stadium. So, how are we gonna do this? What's the plan? As many of you have heard, the Yankee Stadium parking lots are faced with severe financial problems. The parking lot fees that are being generated by the facilities are not enough to pay the debt on the bonds issued to pay for their construction. For the past two seasons, only about 60% of the available parking spaces have been filled. With the support of the Bronx Parking Development Company, which operates the parking facilities, we believe one of the older garages could be used for the hotel development. This will create an incredible win-win for the people of the Bronx and the parking company. It will not be long before you can take in a Yankee game and to walk just a few blocks to your Bronx hotel room. You can clap for that again. That's a good thing. It's a good plan. My office, together with Governor Andrew Cuomo, as well as city and federal officials, is working to make sure that the Hunts Point Market and the thousands of jobs it provides stays right here in the Bronx. I don't know if you heard the rumors, but while certain Machiavellian municipalities across the Hudson River have attempted to woo, you know, those folks in Jersey, have attempted to woo the market away, we have made real progress in the past few months and the last couple of days, and I'm confident that a new deal with the market's tenants will be reached in the near future. This spring, we will also release a comprehensive plan for the redevelopment of the Kingsbridge Armory. Now, last year, I announced the creation of the Kingsbridge Armory Task Force, co-chaired by myself and Councilman Fernando Cabrera, which will be charged with developing a plan for the future of this historic structure. Many have said that no one will ever be interested in the reuse of the Kingsbridge Armory, and I say those people are wrong. The interest in the Army we have seen has been amazing and enthusiastic. We have heard from healthcare, cultural and educational institutions about the use of this building. The film industry has expressed great interest and many studios across the city, such as Kaufman Astoria and Silver Cup, came to us with plans that would duplicate their success elsewhere, right here in the Bronx in the Armory. We heard from one developer, New York Arena Management, who wants to convert part of the Armory into a sports arena. Officials from the YMCA also visited us, interested in replicating their success at the Park Slope Armory in Brooklyn. You can clap for that as well. Much has been said about the Armory, but no one can argue that Fordham Road, which sits one subway stop away from the Kingsbridge Armory, would not have been devastated by a retail mall. In the summer, and my wife knows a little bit about this, shoppers would have abandoned Fordham Road for the air conditioning. In the winter, the same would have been said for the heat. A covered, climate-controlled shopping mall, the end of Fordham Road as we know it, and all at taxpayer expense. Now, I believe that there are alternatives. In October, New York University's Robert F. Wagner Graduate School of Public Service chose the Kingsbridge Armory for a study through its highly competitive capstone program. The capstone program is very well respected, so much so that multiple city agencies have used its services to design and plan major developments. For several months, Capstone has been providing our task force with valuable support as we move forward to developing a new plan for the Armory. The report of this task force must be the cornerstone of a new RFP, and I invite Mayor Bloomberg to join with me to responsibly redevelop the Kingsbridge Armory. Responsible redevelopment means that whatever plan we choose has a direct positive impact on all citizens, not just an elite few. Now, right here in the Bronx, the poverty rate is 28.5%. 28.5%. A recent report by the Fiscal Policy Institute found that the bottom 90% of city income earners make 34.5% of all the money made in New York City. Now, let me say that again. The report found that the bottom 90% of all city income earners make just 34.5% of all the money made in New York City. In contrast, the top 1%, just 1% of the city's income earners make about 44% of all the money made in New York. In fact, the same study noted that between 1990 and 2007, hourly wages in the city actually fell almost 9%. These numbers are even more shocking when one looks at how much development has taken place in the past decade. Since 2002, more than $11 billion in new development took place in the Bronx. Yet, we still have the highest poverty rate of any urban county in the United States. Think about that. $11 billion. And yet we still have the highest poverty rates of any urban county in the United States. Now, how do we address this? How do we reconcile? What types of solutions are we going to have to fill this income gap? How do we make it so that these developments work to make and help to have it and have all the Bronxites come together and prosper? How do we have this development work for one Bronx? We have a real problem in this city. And this is why I am leading the fight to pass the Fair Wages for New Yorkers Act. This is a bill sponsored by City Council members Oliver Coppell and Annabelle Palmer. And this bill will require developers who receive heavy taxpayer subsidies for their projects to provide a living wage. Not only is this the right thing to do to lift our people out of poverty, it is sound economic policy. A study of 15 cities with similar living wage laws by the Center for American Progress found that wage standards, such as the ones required in this bill, do not have a negative impact on job creation. This report also is not the only credible research that we have on the positive effects of a living wage law. Professor Robert Pollan of the University of Massachusetts has done extensive research on living wage laws as well. And he has found that such laws give workers more money to save, allowing them to lower their debt and make much needed purchases. I believe that fiscal conservatives, some of you are here today, should join with me in supporting this legislation, as Pollan's research demonstrates that these wage standards reduce the reliance on food stamps, welfare, and other government assistance. 29 members of the City Council have already signed on to this bill, putting us another step closer to making living wage the law here in New York City. This year, I will work to ensure that the City Council hold hearings on this legislation so that we may begin the discussion on changing our city's wage structure in earnest. It is time to hold hearings on this legislation and for the City Council to bring this to a vote. The people of New York City cannot afford to wait any longer. We've worked to improve the quality of life for all Bronxites. And we also worked throughout last year to make sure all Bronxites were counted by participating in the United States Census. Through our efforts, we were able to bring the total number of Bronx residents who were counted to 65%, up from 56% in the last census. Census participation is critical to ensuring that we obtain our fair share of funding and resources. And I am proud that so many Bronxites heard our call and made their voices heard. The census affirms the great diversity we enjoy in the Bronx, a diversity that must always be celebrated and must be used to unite us. I say this because in October, a brutal anti-gay attack in University Heights against three young men brought the Bronx into national focus. This horrific moment of atrocious violence was sickening and pushed a diverse group of Bronxites into action. But even in the ugliest moments, the best of the Bronx was brought to light. In response to this event and several other biased incidents, my office, working together with District Attorney Robert Johnson and the police department, have created a task force to be made up of clergy and community leaders from all faiths and ethnicities and sexual orientation, designed to stand together in the face of future hate crimes. Not only will this team act to show the Bronx solidarity in our most trying time, it will work to educate Bronxites on the definition of a hate crime, on how to report a hate crime, and what we can do to make sure that these incidents don't happen in the future. This is a major step forward. We cannot tolerate any step back. I have often spoken of one Bronx, un solo Bronx, where we all work together to promote the best of our borough, while also standing up as a whole to push back against what hurts us. The spirit of the one Bronx mentality was on display when Community Board 10 condemned these attacks. This horrific incident happened on the other side of the Bronx for them. Yet, this board stood up and urged all Bronxites to join together to combat all acts of violence and discrimination. This to me is the epitome of the one Bronx mentality. And I urge all community boards to follow Community Board 10's lead and pass similar resolutions showing their commitment to a peaceful, unified Bronx. These actions, as well as other efforts by Bronxites from all walks of life, will show the world that we are united as one Bronx. We disagree with one another on issues, but those disagreements must always be respectful. Now, let me be clear. We do not and we will not tolerate any act of violence on a fellow Bronxite, especially if that violence is because of race, religion, or sexual orientation. We will not tolerate it. Ladies and gentlemen, One Bronx is about coming together. One Bronx is about different diverse communities standing as one. One Bronx is about supporting our efforts to improve every one of our neighborhoods. Yes, we are deeply committed to the concept and the reality of One Bronx. In that same month, I wrote to President Barack Obama, urging him to make the long-awaited repeal of the military's Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy, which prevented LGBT Americans from serving openly in our armed forces, a reality. The repeal of this law hit close to home for me, as my own niece, Erica Diaz, who is with us here today, honey, stand up. Have been forced to resign from the Navy for no other reason than being openly gay. Late last year, Congress finally passed a repeal of the Don't Ask, Don't Tell, which President Obama signed into law. And I am happy to report that many members of the borough's LGBT community, including Erica, my niece, are planning to re-enlist in the military thanks to this courageous act. This past year, nothing filled me with more pride and illustrated the spirit of the One Bronx mentality than the enormous response that we received for our Peace in Our Streets initiative. This past fall, we led hundreds of volunteers into neighborhoods that have been identified by the police department as hotbeds for gun violence. This initiative promoted the NYPD's 866 Gun Stop program, which collects tips on illegal guns and offers individuals a $1,000 reward when that information leads into an arrest. We walked the streets and spoke to people about crime in their neighborhood. We went door to door, of some of our most challenging public housing developments and handed out information on this program. We reached thousands of Bronxites, and the message was loud and clear. They are tired of being terrorized in their neighborhoods. They are tired of keeping their children inside for fear that they will be struck by a stray bullet. They are tired of the violence, and I agree, ladies and gentlemen, enough is enough. Our efforts have already begun to pay off. Last year, the police received, since we started this initiative, 181 tips through this hotline, resulting in the confiscation of 79 guns, 158 arrests, and rewarding over $50,000 paid out to concerned tipsters. Now, these numbers would not be possible without the help of hundreds of volunteers who joined us to work for an end to violence in our borough. Many of you are here today, and I would ask each and every single one of you to please stand up. Those who joined us during these Peace in Our Streets initiative in the streets, could you all please stand? All of the volunteers, please stand up and be recognized. Please stand up. You are the heroes among us. People who quietly work to make the Bronx a better place. Let's give them a strong round of applause. Our Peace in Our Streets initiative will be nowhere without you. And we will be back on the ground in just a few short weeks, continuing to spread our message of peace to new communities. And I urge all of you to join with your neighbors and join us on the streets when we take the streets again. The Bronx has indeed come back a long way during the past 30 years, and we have all played a major role in this renaissance. In the early 20th century, the Bronx was known throughout the world as a borough of neighborhoods, of family, of strong communities, working together for the common good of their own hometown. Great art, literature, cultural achievements have come from the Bronx. In The Jazz Singer, which was the first movie in the history of film to feature sound, the lead character assured his mother that when he becomes a successful Broadway star, they will leave Manhattan and come to the luxury of the Bronx. Sorry, Scotch Finger. Great authors, from Edgar Allan Poe to Mary Higgins Clark, have all made their home here. Great entertainers such as Al Pacino, Aventura, Willie Colon, Cuba Gooding Jr., and yes, Regis Philbin, all have Bronx roots. We are the home of Nobel Prize winners like Rosalind Sussman Yalow and Pulitzer Prize winners like David Halberstam. Internationally renowned fashion leaders like Calvin Klein and Ralph Lauren, as well as pioneers like Herman Badillo, Fernando Ferrer, Colin Powell, and Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor have all called the Bronx home. When hip-hop took the world by storm, it did so from right here in the Boogie Down Bronx. It is time to let the world know once again that the Bronx is a place of success. Yeah, we have challenges in education and the economy and in making our borough greener, but we are all committed to the rebirth and the continuing revitalization of our borough, the place that we call home. This year, we will continue to build on our economy to be a force to be reckoned with. We will not listen to the naysayers who say that it cannot be done in the Bronx. Instead, we will show them how. We will continue to fight to make our schools better, both in curriculum and in the environment. We will not listen to those who say our children are already doing as well as they can. We will show them that they can and will do even better. We will fight to make sure that more Bronxites are able to support their families and rise out of the clenches of poverty. We will not listen to those who say that poverty is an inevitable part of life here in the Bronx. We will show them that those chains can and will be broken. Ladies and gentlemen, there are success stories all around us, but the best is yet to come. Please join me on this journey, our journey to a thriving One Bronx. God bless you, God bless the Bronx, and God bless the United States of America. Thank you.
President who just finished delivering a State of the Borough address, certainly a very ambitious and exciting address. Among the many things that you've listed, of course, you've talked about the housing issue, talked about education, economic development, the educational challenges that exist in the Bronx and throughout the city. Is there a particular reason that you selected this venue, Clinton High School, as the venue to deliver your speech, considering the educational challenges that exist?
Well, naturally, I think that it's fitting with all of the work that we've been doing with education to do it in a public school, to do it one in a school that has historic value. Here at DeWitt Clinton High School, we know is one of the first high schools in the country here in New York City. And so what I wanted to do with the speech is to let people know that there are wonderful things happening in the Bronx, not to succumb to the negative stereotypes that we see, that we've been doing great things with business, that we've been doing great things with the economy, we've been doing wonderful things with housing, and of course that we're finally making sure that the city pays attention to us on making sure that our educational system gets the adequate funding that it needs, but also to clean up some of the things like the PCBs. I think it was a speech that not only highlights what we've done in the last year, but where we're going. We're going to have an education summit. We're going to continue to finance and fund our education system. We're going to continue to work with local elected officials. We're going to continue to be innovative about how we do business here. And so hopefully the folks that take out of here today that the Bronx is not only on the up and up, but we've been leading the rest of the city in some other areas. For instance, the all-electric truck. We're the only ones with it.
Right.
And there's a lot happening, so I'm happy.
There is. And of all the things that you mentioned, is there one particular issue that you think you will have the greatest challenge in being able to achieve?
Well, it's been one that's been bounced around for many years is the hotel. A hotel is important. It would help with our tourism. But we're moving forward. We have a lot of prospective developers and operators. We've been working with the city of New York. Ultimately, I think that if you bring in a hotel here, it would not only create hundreds of jobs at the hotel site, but it would do wonders for the for the tourism industry, which will then stimulate the economy here in the borough.
And as to the Fair Wage Act and the Living Wages Act that I know that you're you know, such a big proponent of, do you have a particular time frame for that?
Well, the time frame is all predicated on the city council. So the bill was introduced by council members Oliver Coppell and Annabelle Palmer at my behest. But this is something that we've spoken with Speaker Quinn. Soon there'll be hearings, and hopefully they'll bring it up to a vote.
What do you think the mayor's position will be on something like that?
History has shown us that he would be against it, but I think that we have some pretty good indicators that show that a living wage in other cities has helped the local economy.
Without hurting anything else?
Without hurting development.
Thank you very much, Borough President. Tell us a little bit about your reaction to the Borough President's message this morning, particularly the living wage issue.
Well, I was delighted that he's being consistent. He's the hero of this movement. He started it at Kingsbrough Armory. Then he asked Oliver Coppell to submit the legislation. Well, I feel that it's an issue that has legs in our community, especially our religious community, because it affects the pew. It affects the person right in our congregation. So we've had it passed by Radio Vision Cristiana, Radio Vision, which is our top 24-hour radio station, by the Council of Pentecostal Bishops, which is 22 bishops. So it's gaining momentum. I think it's going to be the issue beside immigration in the religious community, and we think we will pass the living wage.
So you're encouraged by the Borough President's message?
And his leadership on it. And in the Bronx, where Councilman Vaca has been the only one that hasn't signed, so we're thinking that, we're hoping that he signs on too.
We're here with Councilman Oliver Coppell, following the delivery of the State of the Borough address by Ruben Diaz Jr. And Councilman, I wonder if you could give us your reaction to some of the comments that the Borough President made, some of his visions for the future, and what do you think are some of his greatest challenges with some of the objectives that he laid out?
Well, I think that it was a wonderful agenda of priorities, all of which I support. And his enthusiasm and commitment is infectious. Yes. And I certainly appreciated that. I think, you know, the agenda's a good one. I hope we have the resources to complete it. These are difficult times, but there's nothing that he aimed at that I have a problem with.
Bring it back. shelter from the storm.